Hey there, everyone. Welcome to the Wide Open Talk Show. This is episode 4, and today is Thursday, April, Sam. April.
You had to bring it up, didn't you?
It is April 7th, 2016, and of course, my co-host, Sam Lewis, I'm making fun about the fact that something to do with one of his Snapchats today, but that's okay. You know, we all make mistakes. As we pointed out yesterday, or at least as I pointed out yesterday, I'd had 2015 in the date field in this document since we started the show on Monday.
Mm.
So how are you doing today?
I'm doing good. Had a nice morning, just kind of chilling out, stuff like that. So it's been a good day so far.
Well, good. Yeah, my day's been kind of quiet. My wife went into work today around lunchtime, so we kind of hung out this morning and drank coffee and chit-chatted and all of that. And then I did the standard run to the post office, you know, hoping upon hope that there's a check in there. And hey, there was. So
yay!
Not the one I was hoping for, but one of the ones I was hoping for. So every little bit helps. If you've never watched or listened to this show, what this show is about is, well, as the name implies, it's a wide open talk show. We talk about all kinds of topics. It could be political. It could be about technology, video games, pop culture, movies, television shows, board games, you know, whatever. And of course, what we would really love is if you would call in and express your opinions on any of these topics. Or if you've got something that you want to talk about, you know, that's great too. And that number is 229-518-3525. 229-518-3525. And if you do call, I'll try my best to not hang up on you. So, you know, I feel like an octopus over here or the pilot of the Leviathan on Farscape. You know, I need a couple more arms.
Mm.
So anyway, what do we want to start out with today? Whenever I tweeted this out, I actually said it was going to be probably predominantly gaming topic heavy.
Yeah.
Which everything
seemed to
in
be
here,
a day for it.
Yeah. The only oddity is the first story, and we can either talk. It's very lengthy read. We might even just mention it at the tail end of the show.
Okay.
Because it's strange.
Okay. I'll have to take your word for it because I haven't looked at it. So
it's strange. All I'll say is a dude bought a hotel, and he installed grates in the ceilings so that he could watch the people in the hotel over the course of about 10 years.
Well, that's lovely.
Yeah. And he said he did it because he's a people watcher, not because of any sexual desire or anything like that. So I'm like, well, you know what? That's your tale, and I'm sitting on mine, so.
Was his name Sands or something? I mean, what the heck?
No. And I'm not even sure they gave his name, but it's on the NewYorker.com website, and it's a very, very long read, so I'd you know, whatever. I just throw it in there. It's like, okay, this is definitely off the wall. So, anyway, let's see. I don't think I got the audio stream going, but that's okay.
Pulling a Johnson.
Apparently. I tell you what, hang on. Let me toss it in there. And of course it goes right over your face, but that's okay. All right, there we go. They are now connected. All right.
How about we start with this Hasbro thing? Because this is interesting to me.
Right.
So, for anyone that didn't know, I just found out a couple of minutes ago. Last minute story finding. So, Hasbro and Indiegogo are apparently combining forces for something. And this is kind of interesting. They're sort of putting the feelers out there for, do you have a board game that you've created? We want to hear about it. Apparently, this is a competition, which is open to anyone in Canada, the U.S., France, Germany, and the United Kingdom. So anyone in all of those places can enter this. It's not just a U.S.-only company thing or something like that. Most of those people can join. And apparently it's up until May the 15th. So the whole setup of this is that they are looking for the next great board game, you know, board or card game, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is fascinating to me because I always, you know me, I tend to gripe and complain about companies being locked in to just their own selves, if that makes sense. The idea that, oh, we would never ask these plebeians out here to give us something, right?
Yeah, no ideas.
Yeah, totally. But I think this is them, and apparently they did another competition last year, but it was only open to designers in the U.S., and apparently the Mr. Toast card game was the one that came out of that one. But an Indiegogo, it makes sense for them to join forces with, because just platforms like this, Kickstarter, Indiegogo, stuff like that, have been fantastic for games. I mean, there are some that I personally love that were Kickstarter / Indiegogo creations, like Exploding Kittens, which is, oh, you want to get stressed out in a game, but also have fun at the same time. Play a round of Exploding Kittens. You'll get there immediately. of course, I have to mention it. My beloved Contender was one of those Kickstarter successes.
Yeah, that's right.
The Contender.us, people. I backed it, and I still back it. With my words, not my money, because I already backed it with my money. But yeah, the whole culture of it not just being about video games anymore when it comes to crowdfunding, that we're doing a lot of board games crowdfunded.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think even the Mega Man game, which still hasn't come out yet, the Mega Man board game was crowdfunded even. Which is bizarre, right? Given,
yeah, considering that property.
Yeah. So it's fascinating to me that now, instead of just the games on these funding things being video games, it's now extending to another one of my loves in life, which is the board game market. There's a reason why I go to a game night every Thursday and I play a bunch of Dungeons and Dragons. I count those in the same field, even though they're slightly different, but still it's one of the things I love. And to see Hasbro open their doors and go, anyone out here got an awesome idea?
Yeah.
We'd love to hear about it. It's pretty sweet.
You know, it's been years since I've actually played any board games.
Mm.
I mean, it's just, and I'm trying to remember what the last one was. I mean, you know, growing up, I loved to play Monopoly because, I mean, who didn't like to play Monopoly with the fake money? You know, it's like, ooh, I got dollar bills, baby. But, you know, it eventually went to the wayside. And then after my wife and I got married and we'd have friends over almost every Friday or Saturday night, and of course there was alcohol involved, but we loved to play the board game Risk.
Ah, yes. The board game that never ends.
Yes. And I was somewhat decent at it. I wouldn't win all the time, but I wouldn't lose all the time. And it would usually be competition between me and my wife, our friend Eddie, my cousin Greg, and his wife. So it was an interesting game. And of course then they computerized it. And even though I liked computer games, I just never really could get into the computerized version of Risk.
Right, yeah.
But that's probably... Well, I take that back. Back whenever I was working at CPI, the owner and my boss, Scott, would like to do these board games. And I forget the name of one, but it was like you had to build... You had to build... like railroad track or something.
Ticket to Ride.
That's it, Ticket to Ride. Because there was there's an actual app for it on like tablets and smartphones and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't play that. We played the board game. And I'd never played it before. So that's actually the very last board game I've ever played, and that was probably 2 years ago. But it seems interesting because there does seem to be a huge fan base behind board games. I mean, look at Tabletop on Geek and Sundry. I mean, I'm presuming it's still going, or at least it went for like one or two seasons with Will
Wheaton. I think it's still going. Will Wheaton.
Yeah. So, of course, as a side note, I didn't realize until just a few weeks ago, I got to reading about, her name just escaped me. The one that started. Felicia. Mm-hmm. I didn't realize that she had actually sold Geek and Sundry.
Oh, had she?
Yeah, Geek and Sundry is actually owned by another company. Now, I don't know. I mean, she's still affiliated with it.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, that was one of those channels like Philip DeFranco's SourceFed, where a couple of years ago, YouTube just threw money at these YouTubers and said, create these channels or create
Nerdist
some channels.
One of those.
Do I know?
Nerdist was one of those, too.
Yeah. And some of them are still around, some of them aren't, I guess. But Geek and Sundry was one of them. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting because, you know, they run 24/7 on Twitch now.
Yeah, they pretty much do at this point. Usually you can pop on Twitch and see something going on.
Yeah.
I mean, I watch Critical Role on Thursday nights, a bunch of voice actors playing D&D, so they've got some fascinating stuff on there. And every now and then I jump on some of their other shows. I think they've got a couple of different role-playing shows, a couple of tabletop shows, stuff like that. They've branched a lot. Of course, they play video games too. But
there was one that I tuned into, and I don't remember what it was called, but what piqued my curiosity was the fact that two of the people from SourceFed, Bree and Steve, were actually on there, and they were reading with like three or four other people some kind of script.
I can't remember what the name of that show is. I know which one you're talking about, though.
And I mean, it was very impressive because there was actually an older gentleman there that apparently he's a big to-do in the voice acting world, and oh my God, was he tremendous. I mean, he could pull off that aristocratic, you know, British whatever. I mean, just like, dude, you were born that way. But he could do a wide variety of other voices, and I don't remember what it was. But yeah, and what's interesting is the fact that they actually show the number of subscribers they have, like in a ticker at the bottom of, if not all of their shows, most of their shows. And I did a calculation one day based on the standard $4.99 take rate, if I got the percentage right, they pull in something like $35,000 a month off that channel.
That's not
including their portion, their percentage of advertising or any other revenue streams that they have, like if people do like PayPal support and things like that.
And merchandise. They've got that going on,
too. Yeah, they got that, too.
The Critical Role shirts I've wanted to buy, but I'm unemployed. It's like, dang it.
Freaking priorities, man. Food or T-shirt?
Right.
Well, I could get the T-shirt. I could wear it one day, and then I could eat it the next. I mean, you know, it works. There's ways of doing this.
Yeah, clearly.
I'm not saying that you'll like the end result, but
you get your fiber in.
Yeah, it might be a little ropey, but but as far as this board game thing, I mean, this is pretty cool. So this is really backed by Hasbro then.
Yeah, totally. Apparently, once the deadline closes, Hasbro's game designers are going to review each of the submission, and then they're going to choose 15 favorites based on their visual style, narrative, and for some reason they decided in the article put narrative in quotes. I'm not quite sure why. and mechanics. The shortlist will then submit prototypes, which, after careful consideration, will be whittled down to 5 finalists. Hasbro will give each contestant $2,000 to help them set up an Indiegogo campaign designed to raise funding and awareness. Hasbro will mentor them throughout the process, and the winner will receive an extra $25,000, a trip to Hasbro HQ, and, of course, the chance to have their game published. So.
Okay, so you submit you submit your idea, your design, or whatever, and then they're going to choose 15 favorites. And then they are going to give you $2,000 to help you set up the campaign and do all of the stuff that you would normally do running a campaign. So it's like, you know, right off the bat, you start with $2,000.
Yeah.
In hopes of actually getting your design funded so that you can actually get it made.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I guess technically they'll give you $2,000 and you could wind up... you could wind up getting $50,000 in funding to make the game.
Right.
Now, I wonder if Hasbro gets any of that.
That would be an interesting idea.
What's in it for them? Do they get publishing rights?
Well, it said to publish it, so I'm guessing they would probably get the publishing rights. Okay. And having a name like Hasbro behind your game is definitely going to give you a bit of a boost.
Yeah, no kidding. Okay.
They could get you in retailers in seconds flat, right?
Yeah,
where it actually is a bit of an issue to try to get an independent made game in the retailers. I mean, Justin Robert Young, one of the ones behind the contender, has been, well, both of them, not just him, but they have been so transparent during this whole process of doing the whole contender game that I know things about crowdfunding that I didn't know before, and there's a lot more to it than a person would think. So it's a bit mind-blowing when you think about it.
Yeah, I've only done one Kickstarter, and it was an utter failure. And no, it didn't have anything to do with cows. But I was attempting to try to get some funding to help, you know, write a book. And I've seen that done before.
Yeah.
But unless you already have a following, nobody knows who the hell you are, and they're not going to take a chance on you.
Right, which now there's ink shares and stuff like that for that sort of thing. So it's more likely nowadays than it probably was at that time.
And to be perfectly honest, now I wouldn't even worry about it. I would just, you know, the idea behind that is just like an advance from a traditional publishing company. They give you an advance so that you have money to live on while you complete the book. And so that was the idea of, okay, this is like an advance, so you got money while you can spend 6 or 8 hours a day or whatever it is, what your writing style is, to try to get the book finished. But now, from the way I see it is, I wouldn't do that because it may take me 2 or 3 times longer to write it, but eventually I get it written, and then I'm going to publish it through Amazon anyway. So the most cost that I would have invested in it monetarily would be if I wanted to pay somebody to either be a review editor and or design the cover art.
Right.
And my wife edits my books, and she and I together design the cover art. Some would say that is a recipe for disaster. I don't know. You know, it could be. I mean, I'm not sitting here rolling in the dough on the 2 books that I have written, but, you know, I made a few $100, so it was worth it at the time.
Yeah.
All right, so enough about the Hasbro thingy. That's pretty cool. I wish everyone the best that attempts to get into that and the finalist, and maybe we'll get some cool board games out of it.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to try to keep an eye on this and see how it goes.
All right, so you want to talk about the congressman thing?
Yeah, let's do this. And again, this is going to be one of those on-the-fly things. You said you knew a little bit about this, right?
I saw the blurb about it yesterday or something. Basically, what I know about it is a congressman is being investigated because of his campaign funds were used to buy Steam games. So that's pretty much all I know about it at this point.
How about we read the article and do it? Does that work?
Sure.
Okay. What would you do if you had access to millions of dollars in campaign funds? You probably blow it on some video games, right? Actually, I wouldn't. That's highly problematic. That's what the records say happened with $1,302 of the money earmarked for the campaign of Congressman Duncan Hunter, a Republican from California. Because, of course, this would happen to a person in California.
And a Republican.
Yeah, interesting, right?
No self-respecting Democrat would ever be caught like this. They would hide it better.
This is the fun we have when we're on neither side of the argument, right?
That's right.
As the San Diego Tribune reports, a Hunter spokesman says that the charges originally stemmed from Hunter's teenage son who, quote, used his father's credit card for one game, after which, quote, several unauthorized charges resulted after the father tried to close access to the website. That's a bit of a pat explanation, considering that the Steam games were charged to Hunter's campaign account on 68 separate occasions between October 13th and December 16th, with $96 spent in one instance. Managing your various payment methods on Steam can be a little difficult, but that's a long time for a parent to utterly fail at, quote, closing access to the website. While the FEC isn't formally investigating Hunter for the charges, his treasurer has until May the 9th to respond to a letter requesting more information about the unauthorized, quote, personal use of campaign funds. The expenses are marked in a campaign. Take two. The expenses are marked in campaign documents as personal expense to be paid back. But Hunter's spokesperson said that there won't be any paying back. There won't be any paying anything back there pending the outcome of the fraud investigation, depending on how long that takes. We can't help but wonder if Hunter tried to make use of Steam's recently implemented refund policy, even if he can't prove any fraud happened on Steam's part. Hunter, who was elected to the San Diego area district, his father once... It threw me off for a second because it was talking about kids' father. Who was elected to the San Diego area district, his father once represented in 2008, argued in a 2013 Politico editorial that video games shouldn't be used as a scapegoat for real-world violence. Quote, "The narrative that children and young adults today stare at television and computer screens developing lethal skills through the first-person gaming experience disingenuously portrays video games as having a corrosive influence," he wrote. "The problem with this rationale is that it conveys an image that America's youth are incapable of discerning right from wrong, which is simply not true," end quote. I kind of like this guy now. Outside of gaming, Hunter gained the national notoriety in February for the vaping from an e-cigarette during a House hearing debating ban on vaping in planes.
The article that I saw, that was the picture that they showed. Is he was sitting there in Congress vaping. And I'm like, what was that even about? Because I didn't get the reference at the time, but now I understand.
This guy's kind of awesome. Too bad he screwed up in this.
All right, I gotta find him, see if I can find that picture now. Maybe I should go to, like, images.
That might help.
Where's the vaping? How about I put vaping?
Is Google failing you?
Nah, I found it. It's on there it is. Hang on a second.
Someone made a GIF of it.
Yep. Yep.
And the person off to the side that doesn't understand that's not smoke, so they were doing the fan dance.
Yep.
This guy's eyes have a distinctly, I don't give an F look to them, don't I?
Pretty much. Oh, goodness. Okay. Well, he's pretty cool. So... basically, what we're saying is it boils down to his teenage son got a hold of his credit card for one game.
That's what we're saying. It feels off, though.
Yeah. So he used his father's credit card for one game, after which several unauthorized charges resulted after the father tried to close access to the website. Yeah. Huh. Yeah, the 68 separate occasions between October 13th and December 16th. I mean, let's be fair. During this time, Steam has those Steam sales.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just very, very difficult to get away from the allure of a $30 game for $5.
Oh, there are some times of the year I don't open Steam, period. It's like, I'll get back to that game later. I'm not falling for this.
I know. You have to be careful during the summer and during the holiday season.
Oh, yeah.
Because I've known people that will spend during those sales periods $200 to $500 in games. And what's sad about it is they never play them.
Yeah.
It's like, I want that, I want that, I want that. Okay. You know, it's like a site that did, and I mean, it's somewhat subjective, but it takes your Steam ID and it tries to do a calculation of how much your actual account is worth. You know, based on the value of a game, you know, a $60 game may actually have a value of 80 or 90 or whatever. And I know the producer went through and did some analysis of that too. But yeah, there's a lot of people that will, I mean, I've got games on my Steam account that I did buy because they were on sale and I have never once played them.
Oh, me too. My latest haul that I did before I was unemployed was with the justification of, oh no, I'm building a studio PC. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to do some Let's Plays of these things in the future. Now, if I'm ever going to do that, I don't know.
Yeah.
But that was the justification at the time. Hopefully it actually is justified.
Well, you'll get there. You'll definitely mm-hmm. get there. Can't keep a good man down.
Mm.
Or even a ginger. So
I'm soulless, dang it. You can't knock me down.
You know, this next article, actually, it took me a second to realize what it was even talking about, and then I had to go look it up. And the only reason why I had any, I guess, what went off in my brain was this BlueStacks was because Tyler's actually used this before.
Mm.
But, For the sake of
disclosure.
Well, not necessarily disclosure, other than the fact that yes, my older son does work for Twitch.
Take a drink, everybody.
That's it. But because it seems like there's more than one story dealing with Twitch today. Mm-hmm. BlueStacks is an app player that mm-hmm. lets you run mobile apps in full screen and on your Windows and Mac PC.
That's right. I remember this now. I used BlueStacks at one point, and then I realized that they were going to pay me monthly for it or make me pay something that was ridiculous. And I went, oh, no, I'm good.
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure about that part, but I know that Tyler has used it for, like, tinkering around with app development for Androids. So anyway, knowing what that is, now it's come out that Twitch broadcasts can now be streamed directly to BlueStacks and vice versa.
Oh, okay.
I don't want to win a Samsung S7 or an S7 Edge. Go away.
I had to click off the same thing.
All right, so Twitch broadcasts are now able to stream directly to BlueStacks, and you will also be able to stream from BlueStacks through Twitch. See, that one makes sense to me. I'm not jiving with the whole broadcast can now stream directly to BlueStacks. I'm not getting that yet. So, the two companies are working together to make it easier for gamers to broadcast what they're playing and make it easier for people to watch those broadcasts. Both Twitch and BlueStacks have enabled new APIs that the teams made use of to allow for all of this integration to be utilized with just a single click. BlueStacks product manager Shashi Kant Sharma. Oh, help me, Lord. Anyway,
I think you're as close as either of us are going to get on that name.
I am so sorry if I just butchered your name, but told us, Quote, up until now, it's been extremely tricky to stream an Android game to Twitch. We've worked to consolidate everything onto one device, your PC. It just happens to be the most popular device to stream games from anyway. It's a seamless match. Yeah, that's great. I'm not one to play Android games on my computer anyway, because quite honestly, I've not found any Android games that really captivate me or hold my attention. Now, I know there's a couple that you play, or they're not Android games. You actually have an iPad, don't you?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm on iOS and download them on there.
Right. But there's those games that you play, I think, have Android counterparts, don't they?
Some of them do. I've had conversations with other people that some of them don't. So I know a lot of them do.
Like the Marvel stuff, I think, is on both.
Yeah, because they would be silly not to.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. I mean, whether you like iOS or whether you like Android, there are more Android phones and tablets in existence in the hands of the consumers than there are iOS devices.
Yeah.
It's just that the iOS devices are more profitable.
Nice way to put it.
I mean, well, that's what happens when it costs you $150 to make a device and you sell it for $800.
Yeah.
There's that. All right, so this is interesting. I mean, this is a neat little idea if you are someone who wants to load up BlueStacks and play Android games and you want to stream to Twitch. What's not being answered for me is this whole broadcast to BlueStacks. I don't understand this. What am I missing here?
Maybe if you want to play a game but also watch a Twitch streamer while you're playing one.
So maybe there's like a Twitch app? I mean, there's already a Twitch app. What am I saying? There's a Twitch app for Android and iOS, so you could run that app in BlueStacks if you wanted to. Heaven only knows why you'd want to, but...
Well, on Android, does it allow you to do the whole picture-in-picture thing? Because I know on iOS, say I need to flip over to something else and I'm watching it on my tablet, I can totally make the picture go into the corner and just sit there while I'm doing other things on the tablet. So,
I can't really answer that. I know, I think it's app independent, and it may be device independent. Some Androids may be able to do it, and some other Android devices may not. And because what comes to mind is like in YouTube, you know, whenever you decide you want to go search for another video, the video will shrink down into the right-hand corner. The same thing will happen in the Twitch app, but you can't come completely out of the app and still play the video that I'm aware of.
Yeah, and in iOS, they've got this. They just recently added some integration to where you could play podcast, other videos, all that stuff, and turn them into those small things in the corner and just do whatever you want on your tablet, and just in the corner there'll be that little video playing. So
yeah. And there may be a way to do it on, like I said, certain Android devices. I mean, Samsung's got their own version, their own forked, not really a forked version of Android, but their their graphical interface is different. You know, just like I'm using this Amazon Fire tablet, this is a forked version of Android. The interface is completely different than, say, like my Droid Turbo. I had to be careful, you know, because otherwise it'll say, how will I serve you, master? But anyway, so yeah, I can't find anything in this article that really explains to me what this streaming to directly to BlueStacks is doing. So,
because this is one of the bizarre things that blew my mind when I first got into Twitch, once I had the capability to stream it, was there are people who stream things like Clash of Clans and do pretty good numbers streaming them playing Clash of Clans. It's bizarre to me, but it's a game like anything else, I suppose. So, makes sense.
Yeah, there's a comment at the bottom of this article that says, it's pretty easy to stream directly from a phone or a tablet using a capture card. Not everybody has a capture card, dude. I know I don't, because if I did, I'd be using a different camera. Okay, well, maybe someone smarter than me can answer this question in the comments on this video whenever we get it posted, because I'm not understanding the whole streaming directly to BlueStacks thing. So there's that.
Right.
So that's pretty cool. All right. What was the other thing? Oh, yeah. PC gaming video sharing site Plays.tv has passed 10 million users in its first year. Have you ever heard of this service?
I have not. This is the first time I've heard of it.
I came across it in an article that I was reading about the best way to set up streaming or the various software packages that are out there for you to stream to, like, Twitch and what have you.
Right.
You know, OBS, XSplit. I mean, you can use the heavy hitters like Wirecast and even vMix if you wanted to. But there was a mention about Plays.tv in there, and I think it wasn't in reference to what they're doing here. But essentially what this is there is a Chrome extension and a standalone app. And Plays.tv makes it easy for streamers to capture short clips and easily share them to the service. So on the site, the gamers share their favorite clips, making it more of a social network for gamers than a one-to-one, or a one-to-many, rather, video platform. The article actually states, it says, due to its focus on short clips, Plays.tv isn't anything close to a Twitch competitor, and that's a good thing. The services actually complement each other, allowing professional gamers who spend hours streaming to quickly share highlights instead of needing to manually edit videos before uploading them to a site like YouTube. The site's only been around about a year, and they announced yesterday that they'd already passed 10 million active monthly users. That's impressive.
That is.
It's available in 180 countries worldwide and features 4 million content creators recording more than 1.6 billion, that's with a B, minutes of video monthly over 2,000 games.
Woo. Dude.
The CEO of Plays.tv parent company, Raptor, and former professional gamer Dennis Fong said, Plays.tv is really a video storytelling platform that enables gamers to share their stories the way they want. We're blown away by the user growth and engagement we're seeing. Now we're ready to open up the platform to developers who have been asking to tap into our service and community. So yesterday, and yesterday being, let's see, when was this article published? Oh, yeah. Okay, so it was published today. So yesterday they opened up the Plays.tv platform, which allows developers to integrate the service directly into their games. So video sharing, like on the PlayStation 4 and the Xbox One consoles, has allowed gamers to quickly share clips. And so Plays.tv is now hoping to fill that niche for PC gamers.
Right.
They have what's called the Game Events API, which will allow games to provide real-time metadata to the Plays.tv client, enabling automatic creation of highlights for events like pentakills in League of Legends, which uses the API. And full disclosure, I have no idea what a pentakill is. I know what League of Legends is, but I do not know what a pentakill is.
It's just consecutive penta. How many lines in a pentagram?
Oh, okay.
Anyway, it's that many kills in a row.
Okay.
Epic
it's like,
fail.
It's like in Heroes of the Storm, how they do double kill, quad kill. You know, it's same basic principle.
Fatality.
Yeah.
So Valve's Counter-Strike Global Offensive already integrates the Plays.tv Game Events API, and soon Dota 2 will as well. Awesome.
Give us some Blizzard love, people. Come on.
I know. What the hey?
the only MOBA that I actually play. I mean, I've fiddled with League, but that was just for some friends, and I hardly get to talk to them anymore because their schedule changed. So I don't mess with League anymore.
Well, what I've always heard and what I've been told is if you want to get into one of the most toxic communities on the planet, go play League of Legends. Now, I don't know from personal experience, so I'm just regurgitating what I've been told.
My circumstances were pretty good. I didn't have many toxic people. Every now and then you get some toxic little and heroes too, so that's
yeah. Well, and see, my personality doesn't allow especially if I've got liquid courage in me. If I get in an environment and some little dipshit decides to start telling me what a moron I am and I need to, you know, no.
In MOBAs, this is important, though. You have to breathe. You have to be zen. You have to let it happen and then report them as soon as the game's over with.
Yeah. I let it happen, and then I figure out a way to kill one of my teammates. Yes. That's exactly what I try to do.
I don't have that happen too often in Heroes, because usually I will be on both the A-Move and Frog Pants communities and send a message out and go, anyone want to do a quick match real quick? And then you'll get all the spots. But a week or two ago, we had an instance where there was one spot that it was going to have to give us. And, of course, we got a... Let's see, what was it? I think it might have been a Rainer that thought he knew everything and proceeded to try to tell us how to run the things. Like, you're not even a tank. You don't get to tell us what to do.
Yeah, you know as well as I do, that's my biggest problem. I love playing that character in Heroes of the Storm, but I act like a freaking tank.
Yeah, and now that they've done some balance patches, you can't get away with it anymore.
No, it's...
You learned that the hard way last week or something.
Yeah, I did. I think that's the reason why I wound up trying out the dude with the guitar.
ETC.
Yeah, because he's a tank, right?
Yeah, he is. He's a warrior.
Yeah, so... I never really played a tank in World of Warcraft, and it was mainly because I didn't want to have the responsibility of truly knowing the fight.
Mm.
That was always my issue, was because if you're the tank in the dungeons, you got to know the fight.
Yeah,
because you're the guy basically calling the shots.
And it's a bit that way in Heroes too. So it's one of those things. I think that it's... I would hope anyway that it's a bit easier to figure that out in Heroes, though, than it probably, from what I've been told, some of those dungeons involved. Because, I mean, you're just fighting a bunch of different characters that constantly occur, as opposed to different instances where this is completely built for something different.
Now, there have been instances where I was playing a pally tank, and I was with friends. And one of my friends, Walt, who would normally play a warrior in a tank, well, he'd be playing one of his alts, and so he'd be telling me how to do the fight.
Mm.
So I'd be up there tanking, but he'd be telling me, do this, do that. You need to grab that guy and all this other. And that's fine. I could do that because I'm not the type of game player that really pays attention. I'm in there just to blow off steam.
Right.
And occasionally that has ticked off a few of my party members, especially after I've had just a little bit too much to drink, and I pull a Leroy Jenkins, and I'm like, I'm going for it. And they're like, you know, we could have won if you'd have just paid attention. I'm like, yeah, well, at least I ain't a chicken. That's it. That is definitely it. All right, let's see here. We've got Rocket League PS4, Xbox One, PC physical edition comes with 4 new cars. What the hell do they mean physical edition? They mean an actual box version?
An actual disc, yeah.
Why? Why?
I know, right?
I thought we have gone so far, and we've gotten gotten so far ahead? You know, digital downloads, dude. That's the way to do it. Why?
Although I did not know this was coming, I read the bottom of this picture, and it says Rocket League's upcoming hoops basketball mode. Good Lord, as if I didn't have problems in Rocket League, as it were. Now we're going to be shooting hoops.
Yeah, definitely. All right, so Rocket League Collector's Edition, which is the physical version of Psyonix Hit Soccer with Cars game, is coming to retails starting in June. Publisher 505 Games, which does Payday 2 and Brothers, has announced. It will launch on June 24th in Europe, the Middle East, and Africa, with a release to follow in North America on July the 5th. Why we gotta wait? It's not like I'm gonna buy this thing anyway, but...
Right.
So, as announced previously, Rocket League's physical edition comes with the base game and previously released expansion packs, including Supersonic Fury, Revenge of the Battle Cars, and Chaos Run, which I know I've purchased one of those, but...
Notice no DeLorean was mentioned in that entire thing.
Yeah, that's true. They tease that the Collector's Edition features four brand new vehicles not yet released for the existing digital versions of Rocket League, but no further details have been divulged about this.
Mm-hmm.
This game has already made more than $70 million against a $2 million initial budget.
Yep.
It sold 4 million copies, has around 12 million players. Wow. They have pledged to support Rocket League with even more DLC, including the basketball-themed mode called Hoops later this month. Psyonix also has aspirations to expand beyond Rocket League. CEO Dave Hagewood said recently that the independent studio has a massive backlog of exciting games it hopes to reveal someday.
Mm.
I like that. Someday.
Someday.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, that's cool. I'm so beyond buying any physical medium, though, when it comes to games. I don't want it. I mean, we still have, until they started offering it via digital download, I have multiple stacks of World of Warcraft, the original game, the second expansion, and then the third expansion. Because those first three were not available in a digital download.
Right.
But as soon as you could actually get it in a digital download, I was like, why would I waste the space? I don't want the booklet. I don't care about the box, even though the box art is kind of cool. I don't need it. Just give me my digital bits and I'm happy.
Yeah, when it comes to PC, I do that too. I've got some physical discs still laying around because you can't get digital versions of some of those games. But otherwise, yeah, it's... And those are like my really old classics that I could probably shovel and find on good old games at this point. I just haven't taken the time to look it up.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's one of those situations. So.
Well, as the producer pointed out, not all of us have Steam. Well, you know what? Steam runs on Linux.
Hmm.
So there's that. And it costs you nothing to actually install the client.
Mm.
The client is free.
That's how they get you.
That's how they get you. Just like all of these other free-to-play games, they get you.
Mm.
Talking about free-to-play, and this wasn't in our notes, but I was reading an article the other day about RuneScape.
Oh, yes. That's one of my old standbys. I actually still have the client on my PC, but I haven't played it with the person that I usually play it with in a long time. So,
did you know that RuneScape is, based on the article I read, probably the longest running MMORPG?
It wouldn't surprise me. I got started in RuneScape in high school. It was one of our pastimes whenever we got done with the computer class. If we got all of our coding done and web design and stuff, he would let us just fiddle around because he didn't have anything else for us. So a lot of the times we'd end up playing RuneScape, you know, because it was free. The school didn't block it, and we could get away with it. So it was pretty fun, and it still is fun. It's got this really quirky sense of humor that I dig, you know. So, and you know me about quirky senses of humor. I get a blast out of them. So,
yeah, it celebrated 15 years this year.
Mm.
It started back in 2001, and this isn't the article I was reading, but it was very. Let's see, it wasn't on the Examiner. Oh, come on now. It's on the other machine.
Mm.
Well, anyway, it got its name RuneScape because of a misinterpretation of the logo. It was actually called something else whenever the game was first implemented. And they said it looked like an old 3D version of The Sims at the time when it first came out.
Yeah.
It's had, I think, two major overhauls, the last one being in 2013.
Yeah. That's actually whenever I got back on the thing. Me and those friends that I was talking about, we went, did you hear RuneScape's getting a facelift? Man, we haven't been on that in forever. You want to just make new accounts and go for it? Yeah, let's do it.
So. I downloaded the client. I installed it, created an account, and I was actually in the process of creating my character, and the client stopped responding, and then I had to basically close it. It crashed on me.
Hmm.
And I was like, well, so much for free. But, I mean, I'm going to go back and try it again. You know, just something else to kind of kick around because I'm not paying for WoW anymore.
Yeah.
I do occasionally get in. I mean, I started to get in and play Hearthstone the other day, but I'm falling into that trap with Hearthstone that I'm the time in between when I play is so far that I'm basically having to start over every single time.
Mm.
And that's no fun.
Right. Yeah.
And I'm not all that good at games like Heroes of the Storm, but I'll play it with you because, you know, you're someone that's not going to give me any crap about the fact that I just, you know, effed up. Or if you do, you'll do it in a nice manner.
Right.
And my play style is I have to either be all in or not.
Mm.
And that's what happened with World of Warcraft. When it came out in 2004 and we all started playing, when I'd get home from work, and this was back whenever I was living in Fitzgerald and I was commuting to Tifton, so I had a 45-minute drive every morning and every afternoon. So I'd leave work around 5 or 5:30, you know, get home about 6:30, 7 o'clock or whatever, and I would actually be sitting at my computer with a plate of food playing WoW until 11 or 12 o'clock. Every single night without fail.
Yeah.
You know, Friday nights, 2 or 3 in the morning, get back up, get the yards cut, be right back at it until like 12 o'clock that night. I mean, it was in our blood.
Mm.
And I wasn't the greatest WoW player, especially in dungeons, but I just, I lived it and I breathed it. I possibly had sex with it. I'm not sure. But I can't find another game that I can really get into to that level, and I don't need to because I don't need it to consume my life like that one did.
Oh, yeah, totally. And RuneScape has this interesting little dungeon mechanic where it will, I think they randomly generate these things, but it will make it to where you can't go in with your own gear. You sort of start out as your base self with no gear, and you collect the gear as you go through each level of the dungeon. So it's kind of interesting in that regard, where if you've got like two people standing there, it's like, oh, let's see, you can take that, I'll take this, hey, look, they hid that knife over there, we can use that, you know. So it so it gets into stuff like that that's pretty fun. So if you ever want to give it a shot and want to have someone by your side on it, yeah, let me know. I'd be more than willing to, once you get off of the tutorial island, to kind of wave at you and get stuff started.
Yeah. Well, they're saying that, it says Andrew and Paul Gower, who actually founded RuneScape back in 2001, are returning to design a special Gower quest, which so I guess apparently they're not there anymore, but the new content will launch in the spring of 2016 to kick off celebrations for the Fantasy's MMORPG's 15th year anniversary. It has also been confirmed that a new skill called Invention will be added. It will allow players to personalize weapon and armor, and the new skill will also make equipment more technically advanced. And also coming this year, it will be getting a new game client technology that is promised to improve the game's graphics.
Neat.
Alongside this new technology, the conclusion to the God War storyline will be released, whatever that is. Mm-hmm. But apparently it was introduced to the game in 2013. So, and nearly 3 years later, it will be finished with four new quests.
Mm.
So, cool. I'll try it again when I get some time and what have you. But it just occurred to me, I was like, because see, my first experience with an MMORPG was my friend Troy. Let me see if I can find it. Got me hooked on, oh yeah, there's the site, a game called Meridian 59.
Hmm.
It was an online role-playing video game that was first published by the now-defunct 3DO company. It launched in December 15th, 1995.
Ah.
Was commercially released in 1996 with a flat-rate monthly subscription. And it is often credited as the first 3D graphical, massively multiplayer online role-playing game, MMORPG.
Mm.
And you can now get it open source freeware.
Neat.
It's being run by the original developers, Andrew Kermsey and Chris Kermsey. So I guess they were brothers. So yeah, the graphics look just like Minecraft. Except a little more polygons.
Right.
So there was less blockiness and more curves. But I remember, you know, leaving the town, going out and fighting spiders, and the clunkiness of the sword, where basically you wouldn't see a fluid, like, sword swipe. You'd be like, ka-chunk, ka-chunk, ka-chunk,
yep.
like that.
RuneScape is exactly the same way, so I'm totally getting you on this.
So I was infatuated with this, and then, you know, he and I played for a long time back when it was free, and then I got out of it, and then he got into EverQuest, and he was a big EverQuest player until WoW came out. And then he got hooked in with WoW, and he ran with us for a while, and he still plays. I don't know what it is he plays. I don't know what games he plays. We talked about a month or so ago, because he actually lives in Texas now, but and he said, yeah, he still games.
I think the only other MMORPG I've ever tried was Guild Wars.
Tried that. I hated Guild Wars because of for anybody that was playing WoW, the interface was terrible in Guild Wars. and they had these imaginary boundaries, like you could literally jump or fall off of a freaking hill or a mountain in World of Warcraft.
Mm.
If you went across something of the way the game was programmed, you could not jump off of a hill. You actually had to come down to where it sloped down to the flat land and then walk around.
Right.
They solved all that in Guild Wars 2.
Mm.
But I never could get into that either. And their interesting dynamic was the fact that they made you buy the game, but there was no subscription cost.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that lured me in, right? Because I didn't have to pay a subscription fee at that point. So.
Yeah. Yeah, so I played that. I've played, oh God, let's see. Is there a list of MMORPG games? Ion, I've played Ion. Guild Wars 2, tried it in beta. Never did Elder Scrolls Online. I did try Eve. Oh my God! If you want to have a PhD in economics to play that game, I mean, good grief.
Oh, I've heard. Yeah, I've heard. And I remember covering a story in Samcast where, oh God, now how much was it? theoretically worth in actual money. There was a ship that got attacked and exploded, and they gave an estimation of how much money that ship was probably worth.
Oh, yeah, and the guy didn't have insurance.
Right, yeah, and he didn't have insurance, and it was like, oh, good God, really?
Yeah, because all of that is based on actual man hours in the cost of things in the game as it relates to the real world.
Mm-hmm.
Because everything in there runs in real time. I mean, if it takes 8 hours to learn a skill, it takes 8 physical hours to learn a skill. Yep. Not this, okay, I'm logging in, and, you know, 15 minutes equals 1 hour kind of thing.
Right.
No, it is. That's dedication on the edge of insanity, as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah.
I have played Neverwinter. I think it was Neverwinter Nights. It was earlier than 2013, but it wasn't really an online game. I have played Lord of Rings Online.
Mm-hmm.
It was okay. Rift. I played Rift. I did try EverQuest. Never did try EverQuest 2. There's something called EverQuest Next. Didn't know that. Wow. Guild Wars Factions was in 2006. There's a lot of games.
Mm-hmm.
I actually have logged in to Maple Story.
Maple Story?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that was, it was kind of cute.
I forgot about that even existing.
Yeah. I just saw it, 2003, Maple Story.
Yeah.
City of Heroes, DC Universe Online.
We're going through some of the doomed ones now.
Yeah. All right. Well, that's good. I guess that's going to wrap it up for today's episode. And this is the last episode of the week. So we're only going to do these Monday through Thursday. So we'll reconvene Monday, which will be April the 10th. So, you got anything you want to plug?
Well, as usual, you can find all of my podcasts and stuff like that at tscn.tv. And if you want to find me more personally, you can find me at about.me/labtech7.
Good deal. And everything that I'm doing currently is at slant.fm, or you can find my other social media stuff at about.me/gdadkissen. And like I said, we are trying to do this show every day, 2 p.m. Eastern Daylight Saving Time, or just Eastern Time right now, Monday through Thursday. And we would welcome your calls to call in and let us know what you think about any of the stories that we're talking about during that episode. Or if you've got anything else you want to talk about, that'd be fantastic as well. And that call-in number is 229-518-3525. But don't call it unless we're actually doing the show, because it'll go nowhere. But all right, so until Monday, everybody have a great Friday and a great weekend, and we'll see you Monday. Take care. Bye-bye. This show is a production of the Slant FM Digital Network. Find more at slant.fm.